Profile Audio presents A Cheesemonger's History of the British Isles, written by Ned Palmer and read by the author. For Immo, my constant solace, and in memory of Mary Holbrook, 1938 to 2019. Introduction. Fresh out of Red Leicester. Working as a cheesemonger, you get to hear the Monty Python cheese sketch a lot. You know the one. John Cleese attempts to buy cheese and reels off a list of 43 varieties, only to be cheerfully rebuffed on each request by Michael Palin as Mr. Wensleydale the cheesemonger. I'm afraid we're fresh out of Red Leicester, sir. People often feel moved to perform a bit of it when they enter a cheese shop. Fair enough. Some of them do it quite well, and I'm happy to wait. But the curious thing is that, when the sketch was first performed in 1972, it wasn't far off the mark. For, back in the dark ages of the early 1970s, you would have been hard-pressed to buy a decent piece of British cheese. Of course there was Stilton for Christmas, and blocks of cheddar the rest of the year, maybe even some Cheshire or Lancashire, but that was pretty much your lot. British cheese had become virtually extinct, as had the tradition of farmhouse dairies. Stilton aside, the cheese of Britain and Ireland was virtually all factory-produced, acceptable perhaps for a Welsh rarebit, or as a cube on a cocktail stick poised between a bottled olive and a pineapple chunk. But if you wanted fancy cheese for a cheeseboard, it was French or Italian, and even then only half a dozen kinds. Which makes this audiobook something of a miracle. The British Isles today boasts more than 800 named cheeses, from soft cheeses like the fresh and delicate goat's milk paroche, to full-on funky washed rinds like the aptly named Renegade Monk. Renegade is also a great example of a new current in cheesemaking. As a combination of washed rind and blue, it's a modern mashup of two distinct cheese styles. At the same time, there has been a revival of some classic farmhouse varieties which had all but disappeared. Rich, smooth and earthy, Sparkenhoe Red Leicester is a great example of this resurgence of tradition. You can buy these local artisanal cheeses at farmers' markets and dedicated cheese shops, and there are decent arrays at any respectable supermarket. Charles de Gaulle famously asked, "How can you govern a country that has 246 varieties of cheese?" Well, we too have become that country. But how did all this happen? How did we create dozens of regional varieties in farmhouses all across the British Isles? How did the first British cheese get made, for that matter? How was the world of cheesemaking revolutionised in the Middle Ages by the labours of monks? Why then did we allow our cheeses to disappear in the first half of the 20th century? And just how did we get them back in its last decades? That is the subject of this audiobook, and, as you read on, I hope to reveal that its title is not as fanciful as it might first appear. You can, in a very real sense, explore the history of the British Isles through the cheeses its people have made, from the arrival of farming in Neolithic times right through to the present. I have divided the history of the British Isles into 10 periods, each of them accompanied by a cheese that characterises the era. Of course, I'm not saying that Stilton is the only cheese that mattered in the 18th century, nor that the only way to look at the Industrial Revolution is with a ploughman's lunch of cheddar. But the cheese that heads each chapter has something to tell you about that time. I'll recount the stories of how these cheeses came to be, why they were popular at that time, how they might have tasted or looked, who made them, who ate them, what those people's lives might have been like, and how they and their cheeses were shaped by the currents of history, religion, war, plague, supermarkets, and the Milk Marketing Board. Along the way, we'll meet cheeses that have been lost and found, revived, reinvented, industrialised, or returned to farmhouse traditions. I'll share my own cheesemonger lore and show how to pick a really great example of a particular cheese, and what you might want to consider drinking with it to enhance its flavours. I will also, I hope, explain something of the magic of cheesemaking, how a liquid as bland as milk can be transformed into a rich, savoury and complex food that has graced the tables of the British Isles for thousands of years. G.K. Chesterton lamented that poets have been mysteriously silent on the subject of cheese, but one at least wasn't. In November 1935, T.S. Eliot wrote to the Times in response to a letter by John Squire, suggesting that a statue be erected to the inventor of Stilton cheese. While Eliot appreciated Squire's spirited defence of Stilton, he thought that putting up a statue was not going far enough. If British cheese is to be brought back from the brink of extinction, a society for the preservation of ancient cheeses must be formed without delay, he wrote. Eliot was a big Cheshire fan, prizing a noble old Cheshire against a Stilton any day. But quite rightly, he finishes his letter with this stirring call. This is no time for disputes between eaters of English cheese. The situation is too precarious and we must stick together. Happily for us, the situation is no longer quite so precarious. Chapter 1. Slatelet. Neolithic feasting. 4000 BCE to 43 CE. One wet and windy February afternoon, I found myself standing on a hill in Wiltshire holding a piece of fresh goat's cheese. Not just any hill. I was shivering in the rainy shadow of Stonehenge, trying to pay homage to the earliest cheesemakers of Britain while ignoring the onset of hypothermia. I was also reflecting on the journey that had brought me and the cheese to this place, a journey that began nearly 20 years ago in London's Borough Market. I had found myself short of a job, having exhausted the possibilities of a philosophy degree and discovered from a stint in Australia that only the most fortunate can make a living as a musician. Which was why I was helping my friend Todd Trethowan sell his Gorlwith Caerphilly cheese. Never having tasted proper cheese before, let alone sold any, the first thing I had to do was to try some. And as the complex, intriguing, and delicious flavours unfolded across my palate, I experienced what I can only call an epiphany. This might seem a disproportionate reaction to eating a piece of cheese, but proper Caerphilly, as made by Todd on his family farm in Wales, is one of the world's great cheeses. It is made from unpasteurised milk, also known as raw milk, to provide a more complex flavour. It tastes of lemon, butter and earth, and its texture varies from a moistly crumbly centre to a rich creamy outer layer with a grey and white mould rind that has the feel of soft felt. I started asking Todd a lot of questions. How does milk turn into this? And why doesn't all cheese taste this good? Todd did his best, but in the end, perhaps to stop me bothering him, he recommended me for a job at Neil's Yard Dairy, a shop famous since the 1980s for its range of British and Irish cheese. In my interview for the dairy, I was careful to make it clear that this would only be a temporary thing, as I would soon be resuming my career as a jazz pianist. And then I ended up working at the dairy for 6 years. I worked on the retail counter and did time in the cellars turning the cheeses. I also began visiting some of the great cheesemakers of Britain and Ireland, and, by making cheese with them, began to understand how flavours are influenced not just by technique, but by what a French winemaker would call terroir, the soil, the local climate, and the culture of the people who make the cheese. That might explain how I ended up at Stonehenge, but not how the cheese got there. To do so, we will have to go back several millennia to the Middle East, where cheesemaking was invented. Or perhaps it would be more truthful to say, discovered. The earliest direct evidence for cheese appears in what is now northern Turkey, in archaeological finds from 6500 BC, in the form of milk fat deposits on potsherds. That means cheesemaking began soon after the domestication of animals, but about 1,000 years before adult humans developed the ability to digest milk. The first evidence for this trait, known as adult lactase persistence, lactase is the enzyme needed to digest milk, appears in what is now Hungary in around 5500 BCE. So perhaps cheese was, at its onset, a way of making milk digestible to humans, a neat trick that resulted from a combination of prehistoric appetite, inquisitiveness, and ingenuity. The earliest cheeses were probably made from goat's milk, since goats were among the first animals to be domesticated. But how did anyone figure out the steps that are necessary to convert the milk they could not tolerate into the tasty cheese they could happily consume? I have an answer, a story I like to call the foolhardy herder. Picture, if you will, a goat herd hanging out with his newly domesticated companions somewhere on a rocky plateau in the Zagros Mountains, which border Iran, Iraq, and Turkey, 8,000 or 9,000 years ago. It's hot, and he's been on his feet all day. He's hungry and thirsty, so he decides to drink some goat's milk, even though it's always made him sick before. The milk he tries has been sitting around for a while, and when he drinks it, he notices a slightly thicker texture and a pleasingly refreshing sourness. What he notices next is nothing. No discomforting side effects. Rushing back to the family cave, he overcomes the skepticism of his siblings and parents, and they set out on a program of empirical research to figure out what is going on, i.e. they drink a lot of milk. After a few false starts, they realize they can drink the milk if it's gone a bit sour. What's happened is that the lactophilic bacteria hanging about in the vicinity have converted the lactose in the milk into lactic acid. This coagulates the milk, which, if drained, becomes a form of Ur cheese. Ur cheese, or cream cheese to give it its modern name, is not the complex and delicious foodstuff that has inspired this audiobook. Cream cheese isn't very long-lasting. All the moisture means that it goes off in a matter of days. So, to make it last and develop more flavour, you need a little more accidental science. You need to dry your curd using some kind of coagulant. Happily for the Ur cheese makers, this coagulant existed in the stomachs of the animals they were herding. A substance called rennet, which encourages milk proteins to knit together while allowing the liquid whey, which is mostly water, to escape. And, beyond that, there is just one final step in cheese making: adding salt, which provides taste, draws more moisture, and happily adds another element of protection from the wrong sort of bacteria. So cheese is really just milk that has used three classic ways of preserving food: pickling, drying, and salting, each of which could be discovered over a millennium or two by accident. Farming, including dairying and cheesemaking, was part of the Neolithic package that gradually spread out from the Fertile Crescent, modern Iran, Syria, and bits of Turkey and Iraq, and up through northern Europe, arriving in the British Isles around 4000 BCE. This was 1,000 years before the main phase of building at Stonehenge began, which was fortuitous to say the least. Cheese, as a portable protein and mineral-rich foodstuff, enables people to travel and settle beyond their own lands. It must also have been incredibly handy for Neolithic builders dragging those big stones about. Back to the field in Wiltshire then. I had decided, despite persistent cold rain, to approach the stone circle on foot, as the people who built it and worshipped there would have done. On the outskirts of Amesbury, I abandoned the road for a long, straight prehistoric track, which took me through fields of turnips and sheep towards the crest of a hill. Stonehenge was frustratingly hidden from view, but as I walked up the track, with larks ascending around me, it was easy to imagine the ancient pilgrims walking this same road. When I reached the crest, I found myself among a cluster of grave mounds with gnarled trees crowning them, and then I caught a first view of the Henge, about a mile away across a valley. Even through a mizzle of sleety rain, it's quite a sight, and it must have made an almighty impression on those Neolithic folk when the freshly cut circle of stones were a dazzling feat of engineering, and all the more amazing when the sun came up at the summer solstice. Having communed with the stones, I headed off to the visitor centre, where I had an appointment with some Neolithic farmers, in a manner of speaking. Jill and Mark Hatch are historical reenactors with a special interest in food, and I had been introduced to them by my friend Jess, who is by happy coincidence both the PR manager for Stonehenge and married to Todd Trethowan, he of the Gorwith Caerphilly. In the world of cheese, everything is connected. Jill and Mark were to be found sitting beside a small campfire making Neolithic cheese, dressed in leather jerkins and woolen clothes. Jill was beating some greyish milky liquid in a clay pot with a wooden pestle, making butter, while Mark was giving a quarter turn to a blackened bell-shaped pot full of milk nestled next to the fire. In other words, a Neolithic cheese vat. Without standing on ceremony, I produced my cheese for them to take a look at. It was a small round of slatelet, a very simple fresh cheese, which you could make with a couple of bowls, a colander, and a spoon. I wanted to know if Jill and Mark thought that this was the sort of thing that people had been making about 5,500 years ago. "Absolutely," said Jill. "I mean, it's not as if they'd been cheddaring. They wouldn't have had all that sort of kit." Cheddaring is a thing that you do to make cheddar and other hard cheeses. It requires big steel vats and curd mills, among other things. That settled, and because we were all British, we started talking about the weather. Jill pointed out that it's unlikely Neolithic dairy farmers would have made cheese in the winter. For a start, there wasn't much milk around. At the onset of winter, You slaughtered the animals you thought wouldn't make it through to spring. This was before farmers wintered their stock on root crops and silage. And the ones that remained lived on short commons, too short to keep them producing milk. Also, said Jill, pointing accusingly at the pot by the fire, it's too cold. Look at this. No one in their right mind would be trying to do this in winter. The milk was resolutely not turning into cheese. It was simply too cold for the bacteria to get on with their job of souring the liquid. They were hibernating. Mark also wondered if there was much feasting and celebration at Stonehenge in the summer. You've got loads to do then, if you're a farmer, he said. You're far too busy for messing about with pilgrimages and feasting. But in the winter, there isn't much to do. And by winter solstice, you're probably wondering if the sun is ever going to come up again. So you might well want to do some sort of ritual to help it on its way. He might be onto something. The pigs, whose bones have been found in feasting pits near Stonehenge, were slaughtered at around 9 months old. Since piglets are born in spring, that would make the time of their slaughtering around December, perfect for a big midwinter feast. And, as pigs love whey and thrive upon it, so summer cheesemaking would also help produce nice, fat, juicy porkers for your winter feasting. I had wondered if cheese was a staple or a feasting food for the Neolithic people. At Salisbury Museum, you can see the skeletons of a group of four people, a woman aged around 45 and three children, buried together around 3300 BCE in Monkton up Wimborne, about 25 miles from Stonehenge, an early version of which would have just about got going at that time. Analysis of the children's bones show that they all had iron deficiency, suggesting a low meat diet, but that their diet contained a lot of protein, quite probably from dairy products. Might this indicate that meat was a high-status food saved for special occasions, but that dairy was an everyday food? Of course we're speculating, but one thing we can say with something approaching certainty is that cheese was being made. This certainty is quite recent. For a long time, the evidence for prehistoric cheesemaking in the British Isles was indirect. All we knew was that places like Hambledon Hill in Dorset, where archaeologists found cattle bones dated to the middle of the 4th millennium BCE. These tended to be from older female cows. It was assumed that the cattle were being kept mainly for their milk rather than their meat. Given that at this time the majority of adults in Britain and Ireland were still likely to be lactose intolerant, the only sensible reason to keep all this milk would have been to make cheese with it. Nevertheless, this interpretation was, one might say, a bone of contention, until in 2003, a group of research scientists at Bristol University published a paper called Direct Chemical Evidence for Widespread Dairying in Prehistoric Britain. In the study, the authors described a process whereby it is possible to distinguish between animal and dairy fats in residues left on ancient potsherds. The process is called stable isotope analysis, and it is explained with a nice series of cartoons in the Stonehenge Exhibition Centre, if you'd rather forgo the pleasure of reading the bioarchaeological paper. Essentially, the findings rest on differences in carbon-13 values, which are lower in dairy than in animal fats. The scientists announced that for dairy products at all Britain's Neolithic, Bronze Age and Iron Age settlements, they had direct evidence for the exploitation of domesticated ruminant animals. Further studies were carried out in Scotland and Ireland, and, as I promised, we can now say with some certainty that cheesemaking began in the British Isles at the same time as the arrival of farming, around 4000 BCE. That is 4000 years before the Romans. This was something of a revelation to the whole cheese history community, who had previously accepted that the Romans had introduced cheesemaking, as well as roads, irrigation, public baths, etc., to Britain. This patronising attitude towards our native foodways was summed up by the description of ancient Britons by the Romano-Greek historian Strabo in his Geographica. Their habits are in part like those of the Celti, but in part more simple and barbaric, so much so that on account of their inexperience, some of them, although well supplied with milk, make no cheese, and they have no experience in gardening or other agricultural pursuits. Strabo also mentioned that the Irish ate their parents, which I don't believe either. Of course, the direct chemical evidence paper is not suggesting that the Neolithic British or Irish invented or stumbled upon cheesemaking on their own. What seems likely is that cheesemaking, along with arable and pastoral farming, developed in the Fertile Crescent and spread from there. There is, however, much debate about whether it was the farmers or the idea of farming that spread. At present, based on genetic studies, opinion is leaning towards the idea that farming people replaced the indigenous hunter-gatherers, and cheese may have played a role in this. The ability to make a concentrated, preserved, and portable foodstuff from milk would have helped one culture to outperform or indeed conquer the other. And it also seems that the gene, or more correctly, allele, for adult lactase persistence, seems to have followed the spread of cheesemaking. So perhaps cheesemaking plus adult milk drinking played a part in the farming culture's success over the hunter-gatherer, what you might call dairy imperialism. It seems that there was a pause between the farming culture arriving on the shores of the Channel and North Sea and it hopping over to the British Isles. The distinctive pottery taken as a sign of Neolithic farming culture, known as linear band ceramic, appears in Holland around 5300 BCE and almost 1,000 years later in Britain and Ireland. There's a bit of an argument over the reason for this hiatus. Some suggest that the Neolithic people moved easily along the river valleys of Europe, taking their farming practice with them, but that they slowed or stopped when they got to the sea. Another argument, espoused by the forthright sheep farmer and archaeologist Francis Pryor, is that the British and Irish didn't need to take up farming because the bounty of their forests and shores was sufficient for their needs. There is a wider question here about why anyone would take up farming in the first place. The archaeological record shows that populations that made the shift to farming became less healthy, less tall, shorter lived, and began to show evidence of injuries sustained from a lifetime of repetitive toil. But I know why they did it, and I am happy to dissolve this controversy here and now. They developed a taste for beer and cheese. Here's what I think happened. Natives of Britain or Ireland, picking a sunny, calm day in which to make the crossing, popped over the channel in one of their excellent dugout log boats to visit their continental cousins. On this visit, their friends and relations introduced them to a delicious and intoxicating liquid, beer, and a delicious, creamy, satisfying food, cheese. The Brits and Irish were all like, "I've got to get me some of that." Perhaps they extended their stay to pick up a few pointers on the production of grain and milk and the fermentation of both. Or perhaps they invited some of their relatives to come and settle on the islands, promising to trade their knowledge of hunting and gathering grounds for training and brewing and dairying. Seriously, some prehistorians do believe that people began to settle and domesticate crops so that they could brew more beer, and others contend it was the domestication of ruminant animals to get more milk for cheese that drove the move towards a farming lifestyle. And, according to the timeline on the wall of the visitor centre in Stonehenge, brewing and cheesemaking turn up around the same time, well before baking. These Neolithic people had their priorities right. Standing around outside the visitor centre was beginning to get chilly, seemingly more so for me in my modern nylon walking jacket than for Mark and Jill in their woolen leather. But that was okay, because I had a bit of a walk in front of me to see the feasting pits I mentioned earlier. These were not at Stonehenge itself, but at a nearby Neolithic settlement where the people who built the circle lived, a place now known as Durrington Walls. I had decided I had to stand in the very place where the earliest evidence of cheesemaking in Britain was found. So, bidding farewell to my new Neolithic friends, I trudged off back down the avenue, wondering, as we cheesemongers are prone to do, what modern cheese would be closest to the Neolithic experience. I had always imagined it would be something soft, fresh, and made of goat's milk, like Slatelet. But as the sleet tore down, I found my thoughts turning to the Orkneys and to Setas, a fresh and crumbly cheese from those islands that has become a bit of a favourite of mine. It is a cow's milk cheese, and this would fit the bill in these parts, for archaeologists have found at Durrington a preponderance of cattle bones. Made by Anne Setar at Grimbister Farm, Setas comes in pale yellow cylinders about 8 inches high and 6 across. Although you could mature it, I've seen one on the counter at Ian Mellis's cheese shop in Edinburgh with a mould rind looking much like a Wensleydale. For me, the joy of a Setas is to eat it within days of its making. At this age, it has a moist, giving texture with just a bit of crumbliness, and the flavour is milky and clean with a gentle, refreshing acidity. It is mild and delicate, and the enjoyment of a mild cheese, the pleasure that grows upon you. A mild cheese also takes considerable skill to get right. There's nowhere to hide, as every element of its flavour must be just perfectly in balance. Aside from being made with cow's milk, another thing Cetus has in common with whatever sort of cheese was being made at Neolithic Durrington is that it was originally made without a starter culture. Back when Anne's mum Hilda was making Cetus, her unpasteurised milk from the family farm already had enough naturally occurring lactophilic bacteria to get the ball rolling. She would collect the milk from cows that she knew by name and let it sour naturally until it was acidic enough for the rennet to start working. This is an ancient way to make cheese. It's slow and gentle, which milk likes, and in using the indigenous bacterial cultures of your farm, you are giving the cheese a unique character, a bit like that French concept of terroir. As the exact population of lactic bacteria will vary from day to day, so will your cheese's change in flavour and texture. That, to me, is something to celebrate. But I can understand you may need a bit more consistency if you're running a business. For this reason, Anne does add some lactophilic bacteria, or starter culture, at the beginning of the cheese-making season, just to get things going and provide a sort of core family of bacteria to establish the cheese's essential character. There were probably Neolithic cheesemakers in the Orkneys making cheese the Cetus way. After all, the island is the home of Skara Brae, a coastal village occupied from 3100 to 2500 BCE, the same time the people of Durrington Walls were making gigantic stone monuments and cheese. The people of Skara Brae ate shellfish, hunted deer and seals, and kept cattle and sheep, so it's reasonable to think that they were partial to a nice bit of cheese. Like Skara Brae, Durrington Walls was a cluster of round houses which were set in a round bowl sheltered from the wind, a fine example of Neolithic town planning. Unlike at Skara Brae, there are no remains at Durrington, but there are some fine replicas near the visitor centre, made from cob, a mixture of dung, mud and brushwood that the people of southwest Britain were still using as building material in the 19th century. They look just like the huts in Asterix comics, so it was easy enough to imagine a cluster of these huts and the people sitting in them making cheese. I found myself speculating that, if they had pots for dairying, perhaps the people of Neolithic Durrington might have had other cheese-making equipment too, like wicker moulds or strainers to drain off whey, or wooden discs known as followers to press the curd and make firmer cheeses. Of course, if these things were made of less durable materials than clay, it explains why they didn't survive. As archaeologists like to say, the absence of evidence isn't evidence of absence. Given the diversity of cultures in Britain and Ireland, from widely dispersed small holdings to more densely packed communities, it's perfectly possible that these different cultures made different varieties of cheese. Without being too speculative, and based on the cheese-making technology we have found, smallish clay pots, simple soft cheeses seem a plausible candidate for at least one of these varieties. It also looks like there were plenty of cows around, and in quite large herds too. That said, I had chosen Slatelet, goat's cheese, to take to Stonehenge, and as my signature cheese for this chapter, because I think the first cheeses ever made by humans were most likely to have been made from goat's milk. Also, I like goats. They are curious, gregarious, and independent, much like cheesemakers. Goats were probably the first livestock animal that humans domesticated around 10,000 years ago, and this may be due in part to their temperament. The natural habitat of the undomesticated wild goat, Capra egregus hircus, to its Latin friends, was the Zagros mountain range, where I imagined the foolhardy herder discovered cheesemaking. There, in cosy and well-situated caves, lived Mesolithic, Middle Stone Age, tool-using humans, hunting and gathering, though not really into farming or livestock rearing just yet. A fluffy version of the story might have the inquisitive goats popping into these caves for a look at these odd bipedal creatures, and gregariously sticking around, until by mutual agreement they decided to move in. But perhaps there was more guile from the hunters, realising that they wouldn't have to run about after agile mountain goats so much if they could get some to come and live with them. Goats turned up in the British Isles, along with sheep and cattle, around 4000 BCE, signalling the beginning of the Neolithic period in Britain and Ireland. Some of their descendants have gone feral, and still hang on in the craggy hills of Northumberland, North Wales, and the steeper bits of Ireland. In County Kerry, on each 10th of August, the Puck Fair takes place, Aonach an Phoic, in Gaelic, meaning Fair of the He-Goat. This involves a bunch of brave and foolhardy folk going up into the hills to kidnap a feral goat and bring it down to the village. There it presides over the fair in a position of honour, if a cage can be called honourable, before being released back into the wild when the fair is done. If you are thinking that the cage seems a bit overly cautious for a nice friendly goat, by the way, I suggest you take a look at a picture of one. There were no animals larger than wild pigs indigenous to Ireland, which had become separated from mainland Europe in around 12,000 BCE, a good 6,000 years before Britain did the same. This means that, to get started with dairying, the people who brought farming to Ireland also had to bring their goats and their cattle with them. I have been sailing in the Irish Sea in a small wooden boat, and it was hairy enough with just my grumpy dad for company. I can't imagine what it would have been like sharing a small wicker and hide boat in that choppy water with a grumpy cow and a goat or two. But somehow, the intrepid Neolithic settlers of Ireland managed this feat. When I have written goat in this chapter, I ought really to have written goat/sheep, which is how the animal is referred to in every single book and paper I've ever read about the archaeology of the period. I spent a painfully long time trying to figure out what this slash meant. Was it that these archaeologists weren't that interested in goats? Or was the lack of distinction between the two animals such a basic assumption that no one bothered to explain it? Then at last I found a phrase in an article about faunal remains, bits of bone, that alluded to the extreme difficulty of distinguishing between the bones of the two animals. I let out a triumphant yawp at this finding in the rare books reading room of the British Library, which is a very quiet room indeed, and must have startled my fellow readers. I was reading up, at the time, on the Cager Field system on the coast of County Mayo, which Irish archaeologist Seamus Caulfield believes was established by 3500 BCE. 5 miles square, it is the oldest known field system in the world and contains hundreds of individual farms. Although the soil there is too acidic for bones to survive, Caulfield theorised that the system had been set up to manage dairy herds, an idea backed up by Irish finds of pottery sherds on which traces of milk fat still remain. If this was the case, the Cager fields might be evidence of a Neolithic Irish cheese-making culture. Take that, Strabo. But to return to Slatelet, what is it like? And might Neolithic cheeses have been essentially similar? Well, Slatelet cheeses are white discs about 3 inches across and about 1 fat inch high, coated in a light dusting of ash. Being young, they have a delicate, simple flavour, fresh acidity, and a mouth-filling, moussey texture. They are, oddly enough, not goaty. The goatiness of goat's cheese can be problematic, and some people have been put off for life by a ripe specimen. Slatelet is not problematic. One reason for its lack of goatiness is that the cheese is so young that it hasn't had time to develop those more powerful flavours. The other reason is that it is made with gentleness and patience. But what is it that makes a goat's cheese taste goaty, if that is not too obvious a question? I found the answer to this in a paper from the University of Iran on the composition of goat's milk. They've got a lot of goats in Iran. It turns out that the elements responsible for the goaty flavour are short-chain fatty acids called capric, caproic, and caprylic acids. Any Latin speakers will see where they're going with that. These short-chain fatty acids are relatively fragile and, if stirred vigorously or heated quickly, the chains break apart, releasing their goaty flavours. So, you see, if the cheesemaker lacks gentleness and stirs the milk too hard, or lacks patience and heats the milk too fast, the goatiness will ramp up. If the capric and other acids are allowed to break down more slowly over time, you're more likely to get that balanced mix of flavours. Eaten a few days to a week old, Slatelet will not challenge you with its goatiness. However, as a young, fresh goat's cheese, it's only going to be available during the goat's cheese season, early spring to late autumn. Goats are much less amenable than cows to being milked all year round, so their milk is mostly only available during that period. You might get older cheeses out of season, but for something young and fresh, that's your window of opportunity. That's okay, though, because the delicate flavour and refreshing acidity of a young goat's cheese is just what you want in the warmer weather. pairing delicate cheese with drinks can be a bit of a challenge. My fundamental principle is that the intensity of the cheese and the drink should be about the same. There's no point in drinking a delicate Chenin Blanc with a hint of elderflower while eating a great grunty cheddar like Lincolnshire Poacher. The poor wine will just get knocked about all over the place. Also, I'm not always a fan of pairing red wines with cheese, which I know will sound counterintuitive to many readers. Reds can often be quite tannic, and the tannins in the wine can react with the fat in the cheese, creating a bitter flavour. That said, one must be nothing if not inconsistent, and what I like most with Slatelet is a big, brash, Aussie sparkling Shiraz called the 415. Why? Because the acidity in the cheese brings out the fruit in the wine. It's like having cherry compote with creme fraiche. Also because of the mouthfeel. Having soft, moussey cheeses with sparkling wines creates a lovely, sparkly texture in the mouth, a bit like sherbet dip dabs. Slatelet is made on Slate Farm, which sits on a hill outside the village of Timsbury in West Somerset. It was the creation of Mary Holbrook, who started making cheese here in the late 1970s, and is considered one of the harbingers of the Renaissance in cheesemaking that got going around that time. She was also the first cheesemaker I ever encountered. I'd only been at Neilshard Dairy a few months when the owner, Randolph Hodgson, found me having a stretch after a long day of turning cheese in the cellar. "Do you like all this, then?" he asked. By this, he was referring to the whole cheesemongering lark, which he signified by an airy wave of the hand, taking in counter shelves and cellar full of ripening cheeses. I told him I did, which was true, but perhaps a bit odd as I was just about to spend the next hour scrubbing a load of mould-encrusted wire racks. Still, I must have sounded genuine, because he offered me the chance to go and stay on Mary's farm for a week or two and make cheese with her. I already knew and loved Mary's cheeses, her washed rind Cardo, her Old Ford, a hard goat's cheese, and Timsborough, her best-known cheese, a salty, peppery, ash-covered pyramid. So I was eager as a puppy when Mary picked me up outside Bath Station in her little van. There was no room in the front, and I took my chances in the back with a rather pointy bit of agricultural equipment. The roads of that part of Somerset are small and winding, and it was quite an adventure in the pitch-black back end of the van. When we arrived at the farm gate, I got out to open it and opted to walk up to the farm. The road spirals around a short, steep hill, at the top of which are the farmhouse and barns, and on the way up I enjoyed the view of a patchwork of small fields and hills, with the houses and church spire of Timsbury in the middle distance. The view was occasionally interrupted by the presence of defunct and rusting bits of agricultural machinery, some so ancient that they seemed to have come from the dawn of the machine age, an aesthetic shared by farms all over Britain and Ireland and, I suspect, the world. I don't think it's carelessness, quite the opposite. It's a frugal and prudent attitude, never throwing anything away in case it turns out to be useful. By the looks of things on Mary's farm, they made tractors out of cast iron and oak in the 1900s, and these ancient behemoths seemed set to outlast this century. I met up with Mary again in the farmhouse, with its grey stone walls and mullioned windows perched on the brow of the hill. Putting the kettle on, she explained that it was probably a Victorian dower house and might originally have been situated down in the village, then taken apart stone by stone and timber by timber to be put back together here. The kitchen was a treat, its shelves stuffed with a historical collection of jam saucepans, meat grinders, earthenware bowls, cheese moulds, slightly terrifying knives, and things whose use I can only guess at. I also noticed an alarming medicinal bottle of something called black drink, not for human consumption. And there were books everywhere about Victorian women travellers, Byzantine church frescoes, and German Enlightenment scientific instruments, plus some excellent fiction and such farmhouse classics as Diseases of Sheep and On the Curing of Meat. Another pleasure of Mary's kitchen was the freezer lucky dip. At some point during the first evening, I must have started looking hungry, which prompted her to say, "Oh, here's a torch, pop down to the cellar and dig something out of the freezer, doesn't matter what." Which was fortunate advice, for the freezer was rammed with large chunks of frozen meat in unlabeled bags. Not only did I have no idea what part of a beast I was holding, I didn't even know what animal it had come from, which led to conversation openers like, Ooh, that's a pig spleen. There's a recipe for that in Nose to Tail. Always wanted to try that. Or, ah, that was one of those deer that kept nibbling the shoots of the saplings in Low Field, so we had to shoot a few to discourage the others. Still, he ought to taste good. I can't remember which of those we had for dinner that first night. What I do remember is that as a novice cheesemonger, I had no idea about the early starts required in cheesemaking and stayed up too late, drinking too much. The next morning, addressing my breakfast coffee and slice of cold meat, I felt distinctly bleary. Mary, of course, was absolutely fine. Farming people are tough. Thankfully, the commute from kitchen to dairy was not too arduous. Through the back garden with its planters of kitchen herbs and a gate into the yard, then past an open doorway to the milking parlour. It takes about 2 minutes, or it ought to. I was distracted by the inquisitiveness of goats. I'd never seen so many goats so close before, and couldn't help making eye contact with a few. This was a mistake, as they and all their friends came over to have a look at the new guy, causing a goat jam, and making Kay, Mary's farm manager, cross. The first thing you do when making slatelet is to mix the morning milk, which has come straight from the milking parlour and is warm, with the evening milk, which has been sitting in the milk tank and is cold. If you get the proportion just right, the milk is exactly at the temperature for making Mary's soft cheeses, about 22 degrees centigrade, or what older folks call 71. Getting the temperature right at this point is crucial. And when I messed up during my stint and the milk was 23 to 24 degrees, we had to wait until it cooled. Tiny variations at this stage of the process can lead to dramatic outcomes as the cheese matures. The cool milk from the previous night comes out of the milk tank, a steel jacketed vat the size of a hot tub. The warm morning milk has come straight from the goats and is pumped in from the milking parlour to a separate vat. You dip the milk out of tank and vat with a steel pail and mix it in big plastic tubs in the cheesemaking room. If, like me, you're inexperienced, you tend to end up quite milky. Having mixed the milk in the right proportions, we added starter to the milk. In modern cheesemaking, it is common to use a bort culture that comes as a freeze-dried powder. Mary, for most of the cheesemaking season, used whey saved from the previous day's cheesemaking, which contains live cultures. This is a much more traditional method, and as the cultures evolve over time, it will lead to strains that are unique to the dairy, so the cheese becomes a unique expression of a particular place and time. However, the results are much less predictable, both in the end results and during the make itself. This is the same issue that confronts the Seaters up in Orkney when using no starter at all to make their cheese. Some cheesemakers would consider this to be a pain, and some would consider it rather fun and interesting. Mary was very definitely one of the latter. I stirred the whey into the milk in a very gentle motion and with a degree of thoroughness beyond anything I had ever done before. I was a keen apprentice and prepared myself to learn on this first outing something of the technical aspects of cheesemaking, how to test the acidity of the curd, when to add rennet, and how much to use. "I reckon it's time to add the rennet now," Mary said after a bit. "How do you know?" I asked. "Oh, you know," she said, dipping her finger into the curd and trying it. "It tastes about right." This is not the way of factory cheesemaking, nor, I now know, the way of many cheesemakers who will test the pH, or believing that inaccurate, titratable acidity, using various bits of kit, some of which look like Apple has got into cheesemaking. One thing Mary did measure, though, is the amount of rennet. Rennet is so powerful that 50 mil will coagulate a 2,700-litre vat of milk, albeit quite slowly. Measured and added, the rennet required some more thorough stirring from me. That concluded we had a pause, or at least the day's batch of cheese had a pause, while the milk set into curd. For the kind of cheese we were making on that day, a lactic-set soft cheese, the very slate that I had bought as homage to the cheesemakers of Stonehenge, the curd takes about 22 hours to set as the starter culture does its work, coagulating the milk with the lactic acid it produces. By contrast, the curd for cheddar, which uses much more rennet, sets in a matter of hours. Hence lactic set as opposed to rennet set. This style of cheesemaking is also called a punctuated make, which means that stages when you need to do something, like adding starter or rennet, cutting and ladling curd, are punctuated by breaks. Which doesn't mean the end of a cheesemaker's day. Far from it. The main job of the day is ladling the curd that started setting the previous day into the moulds, little plastic strainers that allow the whey to drain off and give shape to the cheese. The moulds for slatelet are, as I mentioned, cylinders about 6 inches high and a few inches across. This is an old form, and indeed I have seen clay moulds identical in size and shape in the Archaeological Museum in Lisbon. These were dated to the Chalcolithic, copper, period, which kicked off in Europe around 3500 BCE. Ladling curd into moulds is one of those jobs that looks effortless when it's being done by someone who has 40 years' practice. It is not effortless. You have to be gentle, but you can't be too slow. Curd is acidifying all the time, and if it hangs about too long in the vat, the cheese will end up too sharp, hard and dry. You also need to be consistent. The moulds should fill up at the same rate to the same height, or your cheese will be all different sizes. And you need to move steadily around the vat as you work. If you dig all your curd out from one side, the curd from the other side will acidify for longer and make different cheeses. After that first session of ladling, my wrist, shoulder blade and lower back were stiff and aching. Mary, by contrast, looked as if she had done a gentle stretch, but then she ladled all day, day after day. It's not as if the goats won't give you milk on a Sunday. For all the aches, though, I loved ladling, and still do. It is meditative to an almost zen-like degree, and it instills good posture and slow, controlled movements so that you feel relaxed and attentive at the same time. And the atmosphere in a small dairy like Mary's, making soft cheese, adds to the contemplative mood, suffused as it is with warmth and the comforting smell of freshly soured milk. This effect is particularly noticeable when you are ladling at night and the only sound is the trickling of whey from the moulds and occasional hoot of an owl. More often than not, you will end up ladling at night when you are making soft lactic set cheese. The curd takes a while to settle in the mould, so you can't ladle it all at once, but you still need to get it all out of the vat by the end of the working day. The time it takes to ladle an entire batch of curd will change across the season as the milk changes in character and behaviour. As the proportion of solid to liquid increases, so does the time it takes to drain. The rhythm of a small-scale cheesemaker's life is dictated by the curd, when you get up and go to bed, when you eat, and when you do the many other jobs that are required. If a cheesemaker says of another that they make the cheese by the clock, not the curd, it is a grievous insult. One way that you might try to flatten out some of this variation is to alter the feed of your animals, perhaps adding some maize or cattle cake to supplement their forage. Some farmer cheesemakers pay great attention to the composition of their milk, largely the fat-to-protein ratio, and change the feed to optimise this relationship. I asked Mary if she ever did this with her goats. "I'm not a technical farmer," she laughed. "You try and get a goat to eat something it doesn't want to." They're very discerning eaters. Sometimes they'll cross a whole field without eating anything in it to get something they do want on the other side. Mary Holbrook started making cheese in 1978, or was it 1979, she wondered, and hadn't expected to become a farmer, let alone a cheesemaker. But the farm was in her late husband John's family, and when they decided the manager they were paying to run the place wasn't doing a good job, they decided to take over. At first, Mary had tried to make a sort of goat's milk feta. Feta is a crumbly, soft white cheese, but her first attempts came out as a hard cheese, so she called it Mendip and sold it as that. "Sometimes you have to let the milk tell you what to make," she explained. "I've never sat down and said, I'm going to make a cheese like this. Things come along by accident." At the end of a day's cheesemaking, Mary liked to have a walk around the farm, making a circuit of some of the more distant fields. Walking around with her and listening to her talk made me think about something the archaeologist Francis Pryor said about the landscape of the mind of prehistoric farmers and how they would have been steeped in the history of the countryside around them. I think Pryor meant that for those people, the land was intimately bound up with their family histories and their cultural and spiritual beliefs. He also talks about the working landscape, an eminently pragmatic way of looking at landscape as a set of parts that must function together to produce your crops, milk and meat. Both attitudes must have created a sense of stewardship among the early farmers, looking after the land so that it kept them and their families, and also for future generations. In one field, Mary had planted a load of saplings. "I won't be around to see them when they're trees," she said, but you've got to put something back in, haven't you? Mary was not a particularly sentimental person. I doubt you can be as a livestock farmer, but she had a feel for her land as its temporary custodian. On the way back down to the farmhouse that evening, we stopped off in another field to pay a visit to the girls, as Mary called her goats. As gregarious and inquisitive as ever, they all came up to say hello and crowded round me. "They're very friendly," I said. "Look down," replied Mary, and I did, to see one of them chewing contentedly on the hem of my woolly jumper. I suppose she'd seen it from the other side of the field and decided she fancied it. Coming back down the hill, we were confronted by a view of little patchwork fields divided by hedgerows and punctuated by the short, sharp hills of this part of Somerset. As often as not, the whole was partly hidden by a cosy blanket of mist. Slate Farm is a small mixed farm, which is rare in these days of large-scale specialised agriculture. Mary kept goats, pigs, some years a small herd of bullocks, some chickens, a goose or two, living side by side. This created views straight out of a ladybird book of the farmyard. This way of farming is elegant. You use the milk from your goats to make cheese, feed the whey to the pigs whose dung feeds the fields, and makes the good grass that feeds the goats that give you milk. I think this rhymes in Old English. It is certainly an ancient way of farming. Timothy Darville, in his book Prehistoric Britain, wrote that many of the settlements and farmsteads discussed here must have been surrounded by garden plots, paddocks, grazing areas, and of course patches of woodlands. He could have been describing Mary's farm. I mentioned earlier that rennet is an animal product. To be more exact, it is derived from the abomasum, or fourth stomach, of a ruminant animal, and in most cases comes from a calf or kid. That's one of the less romantic aspects of cheesemaking. There are, however, vegetarian alternatives. A more traditional option is a thistle native to Portugal called a cardoon. To turn this into a rennet-like substance, the cheesemaker traditionally soaks a bag of thistles in water and then wrings it out, making use of the resulting liquid. This is as painful as it sounds. When I asked Mary about it, she kindly let me have a try. She was using thistle juice in her cardo cheese. More modern vegetarian rennet substitutes are also available, derived from a specially grown fungus, or from a process where genetic material from cattle produces chymosin, the main active ingredient in rennet. As an ex-vegetarian, from my 16th to my 26th birthday, I'm aware of the moral issues around eating animal products. These days, I try just to eat as ethically as possible, mindful of how meat and dairy products are farmed. The hard fact is that if you consume dairy products, you are to some extent involved in the death of animals. Calves, lambs, and kids are, to put it bluntly, surplus to requirements in a dairy herd, unless they are needed to replace a milking animal that has retired. There are some positives, though. To make really good cheese, you need really good milk. And to make really good milk, you need happy, healthy, unstressed animals. Small-scale, high-quality cheese is about as ethical as farming gets. Also, cheesemakers, like most farmers, are decent human beings. I would almost go so far as to say that you can't make really good cheese if you are not. And they aren't just nice to their animals for selfish reasons. Mary Holbrook called her girls by name and showed considerable affection for all her animals. Julie Cheney, who produces a small fudgy textured cow's milk cheese called St. Jude, has a painting of her favourite dairy cow on her kitchen wall. And the Jones brothers, who make Lincolnshire Poacher, have a happy cow scratching machine outside their milk parlour. There's a nice video of this on YouTube. Search for Happy Cow and Poacher, showing the cows forming a queue as they wait for their turn to step up and have a nice scratch. I can highly recommend it for our troubling times. Chapter 2. Spenwood and Wigmore. What the Romans did for our cheese. 43 CE to 1066. The British Museum holds some of the world's great treasures, the Rosetta Stone, the Sutton Hoo helmet, the Elgin marbles. But I went there to see a cheese mould. Should you wish to do the same, it's to be found in Room 49, the Western Gallery, along with other finds from Roman Britain. On the day I visited, the room was full of children chattering beside displays of swords and helmets. It was a bit less busy around the cheese mould case. The mould is a small clay pot, reddish brown, about 8 inches across and 3 inches high, with holes in the bottom. It was found in 1882 amongst the remains of a Roman villa near Lower Halstow in Kent, and I hope the archaeologist who discovered it was properly celebrated. The mould is in perfect condition and must look exactly as it did some 1.5 to 2,000 years ago when a Romano-Kentish cheesemaker ladled curd into it before going off to have a cup of ale while waiting for the whey to drain off. My quiet veneration was tinged with a little worry, though. The mould has a pronounced circular ridge in the bottom, and I could not help thinking what a pain it would be to get it clean. You'd think, given their roads, aqueducts, and other triumphs of civil engineering, that the Romans would have come up with a mould that was easier to wash. This isn't just a rogue mould, either. I've seen quite a few of them now from villas and Roman army sites across Britain, and they are all interestingly standardised, all the same shape and size, and all with that ridge in the bottom. I really don't get what that is there for. Not only would it make washing up hard, but it would leave a groove in the top and bottom of the cheese, because you flip the cheese in the mould halfway through the making process, which would attract all sorts of mould and cheese mites. Perhaps that was the idea. Both mould and mite can be used to ripen cheese. French affineurs have a method of cheese ripening that involves encouraging them. The well-known mimolette is a result of this, a rock-hard orange cheese shaped like a flattened cannonball whose pockmarked rind is a result of mites eating away. Personally, having spent a significant part of my mongering career brushing mites off cheese, I'm not that keen on them. The mould in the British Museum is labelled as a cheese press, but I've seen them referred to as cheese strainers and memorably, in an article about Roman army rations, a cheese squeezer. Ask any modern cheesemaker or monger, however, and they'll call it a mould, a way of shaping the curd as it drains. Moulds come in all sorts of shapes and sizes, from tall cylinders for Stilton, little round pots for St Jude, and truncated pyramids for Timsborough. They are mostly made from plastic these days, although I've heard of wicker ones still in use in the more remote bits of Spain. After a couple of false starts in 55 and 54 BCE under Julius Caesar, the Roman invasion of Britain really got going in 43 CE under the Emperor Claudius. 2 years earlier, the Praetorian Guard had, quite understandably, murdered Claudius's psychotic nephew Caligula and put Claudius on the throne without the blessing of the Senate. So he was in need of a win, and conquering Britain seemed like a good bet. Claudius duly sent over some legions, and 3 or 4 months later, the Emperor himself arrived to lead his troops into Camulodunum, modern Colchester. Thus began the Roman period, or occupation if you prefer, which lasted until the early 5th century. The Romans never made it over to Ireland, at least as far as we know, and the Irish cheesemakers, free from Roman interference, carried on making their indigenous cheeses. As for Britain, we're all familiar with what the Romans brought over: roads, aqueducts, baths, centralised administration, taxes, etc. But the burning questions for any decent historian of the period must be, what sort of cheeses the Romans made in Britain, and how much they influenced British cheesemaking culture of the subsequent centuries. The Romans were keen on cheese, and thankfully some of them wrote about it in enthusiastic detail. Pliny the Elder, in his encyclopedic Naturalis Historia, written towards the end of the 1st century, celebrates the medical qualities of cheese, particularly in the treatment of tuberculosis and stomach ulcers, and claims that goat's cheese is more digestible than cow's milk cheese. He was possibly correct in this assertion. Fat particles in goat's milk are smaller and more varied in size, making them easier to break down in the human digestive system. Pliny describes some of the most popular cheeses consumed by the Romans. As ever, the cheeses of France, or to be less anachronistic, Gaul, get a lot of love. The kinds of cheese most esteemed in Rome come from Nemausus, particularly Lisura and Gabalis, he writes. Nemausus is now known as Nîmes. Lisura and Gabalis, or Lozère and Gévaudan, all are located in the Occitanie, in southwest France, whose most famous French cheese is the mighty Roquefort, a blue sheep's milk cheese. Some of its makers have, as you might expect, claimed that theirs is the cheese Pliny was alluding to. I'm not entirely convinced, as Pliny continues, its excellence is only very short-lived and it needs to be eaten while it is fresh. Roquefort is a blue cheese, and the blue takes some weeks to develop, so it is hardly a fresh cheese. I think a more plausible candidate for most esteemed in Rome would be a soft goat's cheese like Pelardon, also produced in the Occitanie region, which might be ready to eat at 1 week old, and which you wouldn't want to keep for much longer than 3 weeks. According to Orbis, an incredibly cool piece of software that allows you to calculate journey times in the Roman world, the trip from Nemausus to Ostia, the port for Rome, would have taken 7.5 days, so the cheese could have arrived on the cheese counters of Rome in peak condition. Pliny also mentions a cheese called Vatusican from the Centronian Alps, the modern Savoie region. Given that this would have had to make an arduous and bumpy journey down an Alp and along Gaulish roads to a Mediterranean port such as Massilia, modern Marseille, it must have been something large enough to be worth shipping and durable enough to survive, which immediately brings to mind Beaufort, a raw cow's milk cheese still made to this day in the region. These formidable cheeses are almost a meter in diameter and weigh about 45 kilos, or 90 pounds. They belong in the Alpine family of cheeses and are not a million miles distant from the ever more popular Comté, though their flavour is more intense with notes of white chocolate and oddly liver.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.